Disney's Disneyland.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are.
Each week as you enter this timeless land, one of these many worlds will open to you. Frontierland. Tall tales and true from the legendary past. Tomorrowland. Promise of things to come. Adventureland. The wonder world of nature's own realm. Fantasyland. The happiest kingdom of them all. Presenting this week from Fantasyland. And now your host, Walt Disney.
Here at the studio, we get many letters from art students and from people who are just interested in art. Some of these letters ask questions that deserve a more detailed answer than could be given in a written reply. And so, from time to time, we're going to devote an entire program to answering a few of these questions. Now, first off, I'd like to say that I do not presume to be an authority on art. It is true that we've had a brush with art around here, but it has generally been confined to our own field, the art of animation. And any opinions or advice on the subject of art would naturally be limited to that field of experience. So I'm going to refer to a book that has been a great source of inspiration to me even back in my student years. It is The Art Spirit. Now, this is not a textbook, but rather a compilation of philosophy and thoughts on art. It's by Robert Henri. Robert Henri, who died in 1929, was an outstanding American painter. His own paintings reflect the revolt he led against stodgy tradition that was stifling freedom of art expression in this country. But our interest is not so much in the pictures he painted. It's rather in his rare gift of teaching and inspiring others. Not many great artists are also great teachers of art. Robert Henri was both. And this book is a collection of thoughts from his letters and notes from his lectures and art classes. So when I use the art spirit in answering your letters, I hope you will get the same inspiration from it that I did when I first read it. Now, the first letter is from a young lady who is in her first year of art study. And she asks, "Are silhouettes art?" And she encloses this. She writes in part, "My friends in art school insist that cutting out silhouettes of this sort is a complete waste of time and argue that they are not a legitimate form of art. In fact, not art at all. Now, I like making these and feel that they have some merit, but I don't know how to prove it. Could you possibly think of anything that will help me out with my side of the argument? Are silhouettes art?" Well, when it came to defining art, Robert Henri took a very liberal viewpoint. Here are his introductory lines in The Art Spirit. "Art, when really understood, is the province of every human being. It is simply a question of doing things, anything, well." And here's what he says about what means an artist may use to express himself. "He does not have to be a painter or a sculptor to be an artist. He can work in any medium. So according to Henri, an artist's choice of tools is not important. And as far as using scissors is concerned, there's no question that it requires a great deal of skill to cut out a good silhouette. To prove my point, let's take a trip to Disneyland. Here on Main Street is the silhouette shop of Alex and Nemo, who are truly artists with scissors. This is Nemo doing one of his tricks to attract the attention of passersby. Inside the shop, we see Alex at work on a portrait. While nowadays silhouettes are associated in most people's minds with fairgrounds and amusement parks, our files show they actually are a part of an honorable and really ancient art. Possibly one of man's first attempts at artistic expression took this form. One authority has estimated that these silhouettes were made between 5,000 and 10,000 BC. They are called rock pictures and are painted on the rock walls of almost inaccessible ledges high in the mountains of eastern Spain. Perhaps better known than these rock pictures are the prehistoric paintings found on the walls of caves in southwestern Europe. They tell the story of man's artistic progress from his earliest known pictures to skillfully rendered paintings like these. Sometimes in these caves, drawings of one age are painted over drawings of an earlier age. So, if we could take them off, layer by layer, we would finally arrive at the very oldest of man's artistic endeavors. And this will invariably be a silhouette of a hand. There is good reason to believe that he made these silhouettes of his own hand by blowing pigment through a hollow reed in this manner. Although this is one of man's earliest attempts at art, this same technique is still being used by the artists of today. Instead of a hand, a stencil or frisket is used. Instead of a reed and lung power, the modern airbrush, which in effect is a miniature spray gun. And so it appears that the principle of the modern airbrush was discovered by our prehistoric artist as he used this crude tool to create the first silhouette on the wall of his cave. This leads naturally to the speculation that he might have invented other means of tracing the human figure. Here's one way an early pioneer of silhouette art might have tried to please his wife with a hand-painted portrait. We could imagine that this might have been the first portrait. It might also have led to the first divorce. By the time of the ancient Greeks, silhouette painting had reached what was perhaps its highest artistic level. Around classical urns and jars, dark figures of singular beauty pose and dance. Or indulge in violent combat. Of course, these Grecian figures were not called silhouettes. The name silhouette was not conferred upon the art until the 18th century. It happened this way. The French monarch, Louis XV, was notorious for the waste and extravagance of his court. One of his ministers made an effort to stop this reckless spending. But the finance minister's penny pinching made him unpopular. In this political satire, he is pictured as head tax collector. His name was Etienne du Silhouette. His peculiar claim to fame involves these little black cutout portraits. He did not invent them. They had already been popular for many years. In effect, they were the poor man's portraits of their day. But now, because they were inexpensive, they were honored, or perhaps dishonored, with a name that had come to mean doing things the cheapest way. They became known as silhouettes. After his retirement, Etienne du Silhouette made some amends to the art he had unintentionally defamed by becoming himself a silhouette maker. This one of the Empress of Russia is attributed to him. By the end of the 18th century, silhouette portraiture was in its heyday, and great men were proud to have themselves silhouetted. The art attained such a great vogue that silhouettes were used extensively to decorate artifacts of all kinds. Fans, brooches, even rings, and the ever-present snuffbox. Even though these decorations were quite small, they often proved to be very lifelike on close inspection. In the last half of the 19th century, professional silhouette cutting waned, but talented amateurs kept this charming art form alive. These are reproductions of silhouettes cut by the great Danish storyteller Hans Christian Andersen. They reflect some of the imagination and whimsy of their famous maker. With such a distinguished history, it's not surprising that even today, silhouette making continues to exert a certain fascination and interest. In fact, it intrigued us here at the studio so much that we thought we'd try our hand at it. Since silhouettes lend themselves so well to the expression of romantic subjects, we started with a typical Valentine. We combined silhouette art with the beautiful voice of Dinah Shore, the ballet dancing of Tanya Rabashinska and David Lachine, and our own art of animation set to a beautiful ballad called Two Silhouettes. The best advice I have ever given to students who have studied under me has been just this. Educate yourself. Do not let me educate you. I'm reading from Robert Henri in response to a question often asked in letters from art students. However they put it, it always boils down to this. Students become confused by honest admiration for one school of painting mixed with recognition of the success and popularity of another style, along with advice to follow a still different approach. Frequently, a student will ask which one he should imitate. Robert Henri would advise, don't imitate anyone. He says, one of the great difficulties of an art student is to decide between his own natural impressions and what he thinks should be his impressions. And in another page, go forward with what you have to say, expressing things as you see them. Time after time in his art spirit, Henri says, be yourself. Here at the studio, we have many artists who have achieved national reputation as painters, in addition to their accomplishments in the field of animation. These men know the value of Henri's advice to be yourself. I'd like you to meet four of them and see how they put this rule into practice. Here is Mark Davis. He is one of our top flight character animators.
I am working on our feature-length cartoon, Sleeping Beauty. These are drawings of the leading character, Princess Aurora. Now, back at the time when we were starting to animate Sleeping Beauty, one of my duties as a supervising animator was to determine how the princess would be drawn. This involved combining the best features and suggestions of the many artists who worked on this character. Now, making an animated film is a cooperative effort. Each artist must be prepared to modify his own pet ideas in order to achieve the best possible solution to the problem. No one has things entirely his own way, but in the end, the result is better than any one of us could have achieved alone. This was not a simple matter of picking out the best looking drawing. The object was to arrive at the drawing that would look best in motion.
They never want me to meet anyone. But you know something? I fooled them. I have met someone. He takes me in his arms, and then I wake up.
The appearance of the princess, as finally agreed upon, was worked out on a model sheet which all of the artists followed in their animation. This is Joshua Metter. He is a supervising effects animator here at the studio. He employed an unusual technique for animating the magic fairy dust, which plays such an important part in Sleeping Beauty.
This fully rendered drawing represents one of the scenes in Sleeping Beauty. I am now adding the fairy dust, which the three fairies use all through the picture to perform their magic.
Here is Ivan Earle. He created the unique styling and overall appearance of our production, Sleeping Beauty.
In searching for a style for a cartoon feature, many considerations are necessary. For one thing, it must be more than merely pleasing to the eye. The backgrounds must harmonize with the animated characters, as well as fit the mood of the story and the music. Sleeping Beauty is a fairy tale that is supposed to have taken place long, long ago. So we did a great amount of research into medieval painting and architecture before we arrived at the right styling for this picture.
This is Walt Paragoy, who is an artist with a very distinctive style of his own, which is entirely different from Ivan's.
But I had to forego my normal manner of painting because all the scenes of an animated film must be kept consistent in appearance. So like all the other background artists, I look to Ivan to help me keep my background paintings in line with the established style of the picture.
This entire operation puts one in mind of a symphony orchestra, where men who are good enough to be soloists in their own right are thinking only of the effect they are producing on the whole. This sort of deferring to what is most important in achieving a common goal affects every individual in the studio while he is at work. But in his leisure time, he can be himself. No longer a member of a group, but a virtuoso, an individualist, suiting only himself. Here now, on a Saturday, our four artists take a busman's holiday. On this particular day, the subject that attracts their interest is a fine old live oak. You'll notice that even in the operation of setting up, there is an individual approach.
Mm-hmm.
Let's listen to the voice of each artist as he explains what is in his mind as we see him paint his picture. First, Walt Paragoy.
The thing that impresses me most is that this tree is a marvelous piece of engineering. It's a structure, and I'm going to try to reproduce it graphically. Strong, straight inclines will build architectural patterns for me. I can see the tree building itself on my board like a skyscraper. I'm even more reminded of a skyscraper when I study the lower horizontal branches. They are very much like steel girders, designed for tremendous stress and strain. Only a strong geometric interpretation can do justice to this terrific strength. Now, while I look at this tree as architecture, the others see it differently. For instance, Josh Medor.
The ancient druids believed that trees were inhabited by spirits. Now, I'm no druid, but I can see how they could have gotten the idea. This tree is certainly a living thing, full of personality. I feel that I've got to work mighty fast if I want to capture my first impression of all this tremendous vitality and life. So I'm applying these blocking instrokes with my biggest brush, and I'm using a very thin mixture of oil paint and lighter fluid. I use lighter fluid because it dries fast. I see this tree as a living personality, but no doubt Ivan Earle sees it from an entirely different point of view.
Yes, I do. I see in this tree all the richness and variety that can be found in nature. I am not going to paint the whole tree. What I'm looking for is contained in the trunk as much as in any part of this tree. I intend to make a very detailed study of the tree trunk. In fact, you might call it a portrait of a tree trunk. I am working with casein, a watercolor type of paint. I find this medium ideal for working in fine detail. Of course, the first step is pretty rough. What I'm delineating here are the outside lines of the trunk. This will establish the silhouette, or outside shape, of what I am painting. While I am primarily interested in the trunk, undoubtedly Mark Davis is interested in other aspects of this tree.
That's right. There are several things that interest me in this oak tree. First, I like its growth pattern and its bony structure. It seems to burst right out of the ground. I'm trying to suggest this explosive force with an arrangement of lines that reach upward and outward. I'm doing this preliminary drawing with charcoal, and I'm working on light gray paper. Speaking of working methods, Josh is now at a point of doing something that's kind of interesting.
Here I've gotten to the point where I have roughed in the main areas of the tree, and now I'm going to leave off using my brushes. From here on in, I'm going to apply the paint with one of my palette knives. These knives are generally used for scraping paint off the palette, but I think they're fine for applying the paint to the canvas. Working this way, I don't mix the colors thoroughly on the palette, but let them mingle as I spread them on the canvas. It is my way of suggesting movement. Careful, precise mixing of colors would kill all the life in it for me. I consider putting in the background very important. You see, I can't think of painting this old tree without putting him in his proper surroundings, the life and landscape that he dominates.
Another thing that is interesting to me about this tree is its three-dimensional quality. To bring this out, I'm painting these branches in black. The importance of this dimensional problem influenced the selection of the medium I chose to work in. I am using the gray paper background as a middle value. This permits me to use black to make some of the branches appear to recede. Later on, you will see how I use white to make other branches seem to come forward. Of course, I can't put in those branches until I finish the rest of these distant ones.
Here now, I've established the rough outline and the form of my tree trunk. And now I'm refining the form. I'm establishing directional lines that give movement and added form, as well as the beginning of texture. Before I'm through, I mean to capture the texture of this tree trunk, the infinite detail within detail, the bark like a rich filigree, like ancient embroidered tapestries.
In this stage of the operation, I am smoothing in my color areas with a palette knife. I am still sticking very closely to my original conception. I still look at my tree from an architectural standpoint. As I fill these areas in, I have to be very careful to keep it simple. It would ruin my basic design if I were to go in for too much ornamentation.
Now my picture is nearing completion. I'm putting in the white, which you may recall is intended to make certain areas come forward. However, the mere ability to move elements either forward or backward in the picture plane is not enough. There must be good design. Consequently, I have been very selective about which branches I have chosen to make important or subdue or eliminate entirely. What I'm trying to do is to take what nature has put before me and reorganize it into its most decorative aspect.
Of course, each one of us is actually doing that, but in a different manner. And now I'm at the point I enjoy the most, that of creating on the surface of my painting, to the ultimate of my capacity, the rich, gnarled, worm-eaten, lichen-covered surface of the twisted, massive trunk.
As the four artists finish their pictures, it is interesting to see how very differently they turn out, even though they were all painting the same tree. Each of these artists is right according to his own ideas. What each one has painted is not just the external appearance of a tree, but his own personal response to what the tree represents. In short, the whole idea of a tree. For in his book, Robert Henri has rightly said, "The great painter has something to say. He does not paint men, landscapes, or furniture, but an idea. And so a tree can be many things to artists, musicians, poets, and to the creatures of the fields and forests." So now, with our own art of animation, let us take a poem by Joyce Kilmer, music by Oscar Rosbach, the talents of Fred Waring and his Pennsylvanians, and present Our Idea of a Tree.
Lovely as a tree, bosom so atlas.
Many budding young artists write in asking for the shortcut to inspiration. Letters like this seem to be typical of a certain stage in the development of some art students. He says, I have been told that I can draw and paint real well, but I have an awful time making up my mind what to draw. It makes me wonder if having worthwhile ideas is a gift I just haven't got, or maybe there's a trick or formula to it. How do painters arrive at the wonderful ideas and compositions I see in art galleries? Or maybe you could tell me how you and your artists get the ideas for your pictures. Well, first, in regard to painters, Robert Henri has a very pertinent answer to this problem. He says, painting is the expression of ideas in permanent form. It is the study of our lives, our environment. Robert Henri is simply saying, get your inspiration from what you know and see all around you. How about the ideas for our animated pictures? For the purpose of illustration, let's take one of our numbers from our feature cartoon, Fantasia. In this instance, we chose the familiar environment of a concert hall. Arriving early, we watched the members of the orchestra taking their places. As you will soon see, even after the music started, we were at first only aware of the musicians themselves. Then you will see how the musicians began to suggest shadowy forms in our minds. And finally, the music itself evoked abstract shapes and pattern. Here now is the musical composition that inspired all this, the Toccata and Fugue in D minor by Johann Sebastian Bach, played by the Philadelphia Symphony Orchestra and its celebrated conductor, Leopold Stokowski.